Gopi Jana Valabha Girivara Dhari. Yashoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana. Yamuna Teravana Chari. Yamunate Ravanachari.
Yamunate Ravanachari.
Jai Radha Madhava Kunjabi Hari.
Jai Radha Madhava
Valabha Girivara Dhari. Gopi Jana Valabha Girivara Dhari. Jana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana. Yamuna Teravana Chari. Ja. Radha Bihari. Astro Tarasat Divine Grace, is Sri Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki. Is Kavipati Founder Srila Prabhupada Ki. Jai Om Vishnupad Paramahamsa Parivakacharya Astro Tarasat Divine Grace, Srimad Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasvati Goswami Maharaj Prabhupada Ki. Ananti Koti Vaishnavinda Ki. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki. Prem Sukho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadha Shivas. Hari Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Ki, Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopi Gopinath Shama Kun Radha Kun Giri Govardhan Ki, Vrindavan Dham Ki, Navadvip Mayapur Dham Ki, Jagannath Puri Dham Ki, Ganga Mai Ki, Yamuna Devi Ki, Shrimati Tulsi Maharani Ki, Shri Bhakti Devi Ki, Harinam Sankirtan Ki, Shri Prabhupada's Book Distribution Ki, Shri Chaitanya Charitamrita Ki, Go Premanande, all glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pistari Buddhaya Shmi Satrukdas Skoro Swami Tanamine. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pistari Buddhaya Shmi Bhaktivedanta Swami Tanamine. Mistakes that are Gauranga Chandi Shishu Shambhavi. Jai Jai Shri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
Jai Jai Shri Chaitanya
Jai Nityananda.
Jai Jai Shri Chaitanya
Jai Nityananda. Jai Advaita Chandra Jaya Gaurabhakta Vrinda.
Jai Advaita Chandra Jaya.
Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai
Jai Shri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
Jai
Jai Shri Chaitanya Jai Nityananda.
Jai
Advaita Chandra Jai Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai
Advaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai
Jai Shri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda.
Jai
Jai Shri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda.
Jai
Advaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Jai
Advaita Chandra Jaya Gaura Bhakta Vrinda.
Nam Sanctam Puru, if I change the screen to my Vedabase, will I mess it up, do you think? Or should I not take the risk?
No, but it'll be easy to come back to that.
Okay. So I have. Oh, it's not coming up. Oh, interesting. Only the slideshow is coming up. Thank God the slideshow is coming up, but the rest is not coming up. Okay, maybe just one says Chani Torch Media, the book. What do you want? Nothing that's coming up, even the iBooks. Interesting, huh? But that's coming up, thank God. So maybe this, give me the book. That's to the screen with the. Over to the screen with the.
I don't anymore.
Maybe just give me the book. I just have a book. since let's not play with fate. So this morning, so reading from the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhyalila, chapter 19. Lord Chaitanya speaking to Srila Rupa Goswami. So as we've been hearing, it's a technical section, so I've been a little indulgent. We're going to have a little presentation on the overall teachings that are going on here. But yeah, no, I'm okay. So today's text, let's just... So we're doing text. That's okay then. Yes, true. Anyway, so text 185, 186, and 187, and 187 purport. So. Shantadasya Sakya Vatsala Madhurya Rasanam Krishna Bhakti Rasamaja E Panchapradan. The chief transcendental mellows experienced with the Supreme Personality of Godhead are five: Santadasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, and Madhurya. Hasustutastatavira karuna rudra ityapi bayanaka sabibatsa iti gunascha saptada. Besides the five direct mellows, there are seven indirect mellows, known as laughter, wonder, chivalry, compassion, anger, disaster, and fear. This is found in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 2.5.11. So 1.7. Hasya abhutta vira karuna rodra vibhatsa bhaya pancha vrida bhakti gona sapta rasahaya. Translation. In addition to the five direct mellows, there are seven indirect mellows known as laughter, wonder, chivalry, compassion, anger, disaster, and fear. Purport. No, so Srila Prabhupada's purport is a technical purport, where he goes, quotes the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, he gives the verse and the translation. So he doesn't actually give a comment here, he just reads the verses and the translation. So I'll skip the verses and I'll just read the translations. Purport. Shanta Bhakta Ras is described as follows in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. When Shanta Rati, neutral attraction, exists continuously and is mixed with a static emotion, and when the devotee relishes that neutral position, it is called Shanta Bhakti Ras. Shanta Bhakti Ras devotees generally relish the impersonal feature of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Since their taste of transcendental bliss is incomplete, it is called Aghana, or not concentrated. A comparison is made between ordinary milk and concentrated milk. When the same devotee goes beyond the impersonal and tastes the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his original form as Satchitananda Vigraha, his transcendental blissful body, complete in knowledge and eternity, the taste is called concentrated gana, transcendental bliss. Sometimes the devotee in Shantaras relish transcendental bliss after meeting the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but this is not comparable to the transcendental bliss relished by the devotees situated in Dasyaras, the transcendental mellow in which one renders service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that's Prabhupada's Santaras. So next he talks about Dasyaras. Dasyaras, or Dasya Bhaktiras, is described as follows. When according to his desires, the living entity develops love for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, this beginning stage of love is called Dasya Bhaktiras. Dasya Bhakti Ras is divided into two categories called Sambrahma Dasya and Gaurava Dasya. In Sambrahma Dasya, the devotee renders respectful service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But in the more advanced Gaurava Dasya, his service takes the form of giving protection to the Lord. Next, Shakya Bhakti Ras is described as follows in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. According to one's original consciousness, ecstatic emotions may be exhibited as continuously existing in fraternity. When this stage of Krishna consciousness is mature, it is called Prayuras or Sakya Bhakti Ras. Next, Vatsalya Bhakti Ras is described in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu as follows. When eternally existing love of Godhead transforms into parental love and is mixed with corresponding emotions, that stage of spiritual existence is described by learned devotees as Vatsalya Bhakti Ras. And finally, Madhurya Bhakti Ras is described in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu as follows. If in accordance with one's own natural development in Krishna consciousness, one's attraction leans towards conjugal love within the heart, that is called attachment in conjugal love, or Madhurya Ras. So that's the five primary. Then the Prabhupada mentioned the second, seven secondary. Similarly, Hasya, Abhuta, Vira, Karuna, Rodra, Baya, and Bibhatsa, the seven indirect mellows, are explained in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. The Hasya Bhakti Ras, laughing devotion, is explained as follows. When through devotional service a laughing attachment to Krishna is developed, it is called Hasya Bhakti Ras by learned scholars. Similarly, Adbhuta Ras. Adbhuta Ras would be which one? Adbhuta. Adbhuta Shringham. Wonder, yeah, great wonder, amazement. When one's general attachment is fixed in wonder, it's called Adbhuta Bhakti Ras. Virya Bhakti Ras is described as follows. When attachment to Krishna mixes with the bellicose tendency, the charitable tendency, or the merciful tendency in the heart of the devotee, such devotion is called Virya Bhakti Ras. Karuna Bhakti Ras is described as follows. When one's devotional attitude and attachment to Krishna is mixed with lamentation, it is called Karuna Bhakti Ras. Rodra Bhakti Ras is described as follows. When devotion is mixed with anger in the heart of the devotee, the taste is called Rodra Bhakti Ras. Bayanaka Bhakti Ras is described as follows. When devotion is mixed with fear, it is called Bayanaka Bhakti Ras. Bibhatsa Bhakti Ras is described as follows. When one's attachment for Krishna develops in an abominable way and the devotee enjoys it, that is called Bibhatsya Bhakti Ras. In conclusion, when a pure devotee is situated in any of the five principal mellows, Shanta, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, or Madhurya, and that mellow is mixed with one or more of the seven indirect Bhakti Rasas, Hasya, Abhuta, Vira, Karuna, Rodra, Bayanka, or Bibhatsa, the indirect mellows become prominent. Om Ignati Marandasya, Ginajana Shalakaya, Chakshurum Minatam Yena, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam, Sapitam Yena Bhutale, Svayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gurun Shri Yuta Parakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sijivam Savadvetam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Svaharita Lalita Shri Vishakam Vitam Cha He Krishna Karna Sindho Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gorange Radhe Vrindavanishwari Vishabhanu Sute Devi Ranamani Hari Priye Vancha kalpatru bhyascha kripa sindhu bhyascha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namaho namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So this is my first official class back in Shivadanishvara's holy dam. So I was telling Murli Manaharpu I was my starvation in ISKCON Governors Nottingham from this ras of preparing and speaking. So I'm not sure if I'll say anything of benefit this morning, but I definitely myself relish the preparation for the work because it was something I haven't done in a while. So I hope I'm able to say something of good. Yeah, so in this section, it's been this whole the nectar devotion, these oceans, and this section has been a blind spot, I could say, as a devotee. It's just always bewildered me what's going on here. I'm pretty sure I dutifully read the entire nectar devotion, but at most it's dutifully, a dutiful reading without, as we say, in one ear and out the other, pretty much. So with this verse, I thought, okay, let's, a few years of devotional service under my belt, I should be understanding this a little bit more at least. So with that impetus, I said, okay, let me prepare a little presentation for my own benefit, and then for, if I can convey something in the class. So I hope everything works nicely. So, okay, so this is the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Basically, this is what's going on here. Lord Chaitanya is telling, giving Rupa Goswami the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. And as we know it, the nectar devotion, the complete science of Bhakti Yoga. Here's a little one quick quote. The importance of where we should deeply and better study this, the nectar devotion. Prabhupada in a lecture on June 23, 1970. Hare Krishna. So you have published our nectar of devotion. So every one of you should read this nectar devotion repeatedly. The whole substance of Vaishnava philosophy and activities, everything is there. So every one of you read this nectar devotion once, twice, three times, and we can imagine Prabhupada meant four times, five times, six times. Unless you have got full-fledged ideas, what is this devotional service? That is in Sanskrit. It will be difficult for you. Therefore, I presented a summary study. And the summary study has come to 407 pages. If we would have elaborately described each and every verse, then it would have come to at least 1,000 pages. So the whole substance is creamed. You should take advantage of this. And don't indulge in much unnecessary talks. Time should be very properly utilized. Interesting, Prabhupada. Well, I stopped there because that's a very classic nectar devotion point, utilization of time, indirect symptom of bhava. So it's interesting, Prabhupada says, he kept a summary edition. It is most of always understood that Prabhupada had stayed with us, he would have given a more traditional translation of text, purpose and verses, but we have the nectar devotion. Okay, so in our readings, as I said, this is Lord Chaitanya speaking to Rupa Goswami. And this section, actually, it's very small. Lord Chaitanya is speaking to Rupa Goswami. It's only, actually, from text 136 to 236 is how many verses? Exactly 100 verses. Yeah, it's 100 verses only. And when, because Lord Chaitanya spoke to Sanat Goswami, he spoke 3 months, wasn't it? 3 months? Yeah, 3 months. So how long did Lord Chaitanya speak to Rupa Goswami for? 10 days. It's 100 verses, and it took them 10 days. So I've never, just again in my own study, I thought, oh, I never noticed that before. 100 verses in 10 days? And how? If you read the verses, it doesn't take 10 days to read the verses. So kind of what the context of the exchange between the Lord and Rupa Goswami was, would be, you know, you pitch them sitting down for the day, and like, that's it for the day, like with Ramananda Rai and Lord Chaitanya. They sat down, didn't notice the day passing, and night came. So you would assume that sort of exchange was there too between Lord Chaitanya and Rupa Goswami. But he only spoke 100 verses. So it's a little mysterious there how it took 10 days for the 100 verses. Then, as Kartik Chandrabhu mentioned, yes, of course, by the way, Kartik Chandrabhu stole my class.
Because he very nicely went through all the rasas in detail. He went to what they are and who represents each ras and the examples and the breakdowns of the dasi and the friendship. He stole what today's class was. So he, if he's watching online, he said he would. Thank you very much, Kartik Chandrabhu. So then I had to think what I wanted to prepare, so that's why I went this direction. Which basically is an overview, and we're going to discuss just ras a little bit. But as he said, yes, it was 30 years later Rupa Goswami wrote the book. And according to His Holiness Hanuman Prasad Swami, it took Rupa Goswami 15 years to write the book. So Lord Chaitanya spoke 100 verses in 10 days. And 30 years later, Rupa Goswami spent 15 years elaborating on those 100 verses into the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. That's some work. It was, as Lord Chaitanya said, I'm only giving you the summary, the very, very condensed synopsis. And Rupa Goswami had to elaborate it, so he added more verses. All the verses pretty much Lord Chaitanya spoke are in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, but many more verses, and then all these supportive verses, all this other evidence from the, mostly from the Bhagavatam, but then from the Puranas to support Lord Chaitanya's philosophy. Radhika Ramanpur gives a very, 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 very nice seminar on how Lord Chaitanya teaches the topmost philosophy. Srimad Bhagavatam is the topmost philosophy, so Lord Chaitanya teaches the Bhagavatam. Something like this, or maybe he had another variation. That was it. Lord Chaitanya teaches the topmost philosophy, and Bhagavatam is the topmost philosophy. Something like this, how this is the same thing, and then a lot of what Jiva Goswami does in Sandarbha is just establishing how Lord Chaitanya is speaking Bhagavatam. His teachings are based completely in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And Jiva Goswami gives this very wonderful support to establish this point. So Rupa Goswami does the same. He researches very much to establish Lord Chaitanya's philosophy. And Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is it. It's considered of all his books, that's his magnus opus. This is his principal book. So Lord Chaitanya starts to speak these 100 verses. That's why I'm going to have a quick summary of these verses that he speaks. Lord Chaitanya starts with a general description about the living entity and how after passing through the 8,400,000 species, he comes to the human form. Then in the human form, few have any real interest in spiritual life, and then few in spiritual life are interested in free from karma and jnana. So that's the first about 10 verses or so. This is how Lord Chaitanya starts. He talks about the living entity. We're spirit souls. Lord Chaitanya, when he speaks through Rupa Goswami, he starts with our basic point too. Your spirit soul. And then he talks about the size of the spirit soul and the nature of it and its wandering around. And then he quotes Narayanam Muktanamapiti Siddhanam Narayanaparayana, that there's, of all the living entities, very, 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 very few show any interest in spiritual life. And those that do show interest, very few are interested in pure spiritual life. And that brings him to the point of the first verse of Bhakti, the first main verse of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, which is Jnana Karma Navritam Anukalena Krishnanu Shilanam Bhakti Uchite Uttamaya. I think some translations that have that and I've got it stuck in my brain. Uttama, Bhakti Uttama, topmost Bhakti. So Lord Chaitanya then brings Rupa Goswami to that verse. But then before he actually goes into further, he gives an analogy. What's the analogy Lord Chaitanya gives?
Tree?
Yeah, well, before the tree? Creeper. Even before the creeper. What's this? Lord Chaitanya gives about 10 verses. And actually, these 10 verses are what the whole Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is built upon. Actually, I'm thinking. What's the first thing he talks about? The living entity, Brahmanya, Konya, Bhagavan, Jeev, Guru Krishna, Sadhaya,
Bhakti
Lata Beach. So the living entity can wander throughout the entire universe through different species, through these 8 million species, but only if he's very, very fortunate does he get the Bhakti Lata Beach, the seed of devotion. So Lord Chaitanya speaks, kind of elaborates in this analogy. So what else is in this analogy? The first thing is the seed. What else in this analogy? So Lord Chaitanya has his whole botanical analogy. So first it gives you the seed. You have to have a seed. What do you do with the seed?
Plant it.
plant it and water it. The watering. The watering is what?
Chanting Hare Krishna.
Chanting Hare Krishna. Shravanam and Kirtan. Then what happens? When you water the seed, what happens? Into?
Creeper.
Creeper. Creeper. Which grows. When it grows, where does it go to? Yes, very nice. And what's that compared to an analogy? And I wasn't clear on this point. What's that compared to an analogy? Somebody just said it a second ago. So this is the last point. It wasn't a creeper. Somebody said
tree.
I don't know. Actually, Lord Krishna's lotus feet are compared to not just a tree, of course, but the all wish-fulfilling desire tree. So the creeper, what does it do? It goes out of the material universe, through the walls of the universe, goes into the spiritual sky, goes to Loka Vrindavan, and wraps itself around Krishna's lotus feet. What happens then?
Fruits.
One gets the fruits. The fruits grow and they start dropping. And you're getting this ras. This is basically when ras takes place. We're going to discuss. This is when ras happens. Then what does Lord Chaitanya do then with the analogy? So he's described the seed, the watering, the creeper, the tree, the fruits. What does he describe next?
Distribute the fruits.
Not this one. Actually,
he starts speaking about the weeds.
The weeds, yeah. But before he gets to the weeds even, that's my... Which is compared to?
Wild elephant.
Which is basically, he says, wild animals. Which principally is the elephant. So you got to protect your creeper. You got to protect it by building a nice fence around your creeper. Otherwise, animals will come and knock it over. And what else would you have to protect your creeper from? The weeds. So fences are things which come and attack. Weeds are those things which grow alongside by your activities in sadhana bhakti. Other things come along which is explained very, very scarily. Looks like your bhakti lata, but are not. In other words, they're wrapped in all things looking Krishna conscious, but it's something else. It's the false ego manifesting in the guise of Krishna conscious. And what's missing? What's the other thing missing in the analogy? There's one other element, important one.
Fencing.
Fencing is covered with, well, the gardener, thank you very much. Us. We are the gardeners. Says, and as the gardener, we have to plant the seed, water the seed, look after it, protect it, the creeper will grow. Us, the gardener. So it's a very, very beautiful analogy. And actually, I'm not 100% sure if I'm correct in this, but the whole Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is based upon this analogy. This is what the seed is, the activity of watering it, the activity of the growing, the activity of protecting it. Especially in the first part of the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, all about sadhana bhakti, your seed, how to develop it, the 64 activities of devotional service, the offences to be avoided. It's all based on the first four. And then the fruits is what the other three oceans are about. What happens when you're actually starting to get somewhere? The fruits you taste. So this analogy is the basis of the whole Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So now I'll just give a quick overview of it. I'm not going to elaborate on this because it'll take too much time, but just to go through how the books are structured. It starts with what ocean? What's the first ocean?
Eastern.
So you got the Eastern Ocean, and the Eastern Ocean is about the varieties of bhakti, which basically the overview: devotional service and practice, devotional service and ecstasy, devotional service and love of God. So the first ocean talks about what bhakti is and how you go about doing it. Oh, what is that? Oh, my. What is the basics of bhakti? How devotional service, vaidhi bhakti, sadhana bhakti, up to bhava and prema. The basic outline of it. Then we have, after the Eastern Ocean, we go down
south,
the Southern Ocean. And the Southern Ocean discusses, and of course, I have to warn Murali Mahaprabhu not to answer every question. He's teaching here to the ocean. So for everybody else goes, whew, I'm glad Murali's here. The Southern Ocean discusses what?
No,
No prompting. Out of the Southern Ocean? Because that's what the previous week's texts were about. Okay, so the Southern Ocean discusses the components of RAS, which is the bhavas, basically. The bhavas. Just think of it like that sense. The vaibhav, the anubhav, the sattvika bhav, the avichari bhav, and the stari bhav. This is the components. This is the breakdown. Remember, we're talking about fruits, which gives you taste, and which is RAS, and that's what RAS. RAS has ingredients. Think of that. Think of the cooking. You need ingredients to make your RAS. These are the ingredients. These five items. So Rupa Goswami gives a very technical description of what these are and what they're made of. And there's many, many, many subcategories. Then after the Southern Ocean, we go west. And what's in the Western Ocean? There's a clue. Huh?
Five rasas.
Yes. The primary rasas. Neutrality, servitude, friendship, parental, and conjugal. So basically then, after explaining the components of RAS, then he tells the five categories. And what's the last ocean about?
Secondary rasas.
The northern ocean, secondary rasas. Laughter, astonishment, chivalry, compassion, anger, fear, gasless, and incompatible metals. He gives this little discussion of rasibas. That's how the Bhakti Rasmi Sindhu and Nectar Devotion is constructed. What sadhana is, up to prema, what the components of RAS is about, the five types, and seven indirect types. That's a very simple overview of the structure of the books. Because when you read Prabhupada's Nectar Devotion, it's not so obvious. That's the thing. That's why we have His Holiness Dhanamaraj made his very, very wonderful book, kind of bringing the Bhakti Rasa Sindhu together with the Nectar Devotion and making it very more accessible. Okay, so then the Southern Ocean. Just to quickly, so we get a little head around these vibhavs. This is the section we tend to like hear and then 5 minutes later go, what was that one again? What was the word? I can't. But let's just go through it now that we've got a basic. The vibhav. It's the stimulation. Think of it as a thing which stimulates to happen. The anubhav, the behavior that you do in response to the stimulation. What you do, what you decide to do. Do you pay your obeisances? Do you dance? The anubhav, the stimulation, what you do. The sattvika, something happens to your body. Your body responds. Not just your body, but actually much more. The internal energy responds, which affects the life areas in your body, and your body has a corresponding symptom, of which there is 8 fixed involuntary physical symptoms. The abhichari. Then some in your heart, again, some sudden activity just makes you basically all excited. It's a type of intense excitement, something which raises your emotion. And then the staibab or rati, those two words are together, our actual eternal mood, the basic emotional or spiritual identity of a devotee that is present under all conditions. So the staibab is what we have, our rati. That's our basic, of which there is the five types. We have one of these five types, and the staibab is that. That's our permanent condition. And the four other bhavs are the structure, the foundations for your stai bhav. And so then I have tried this summary thing. The devotee's rati or stai bhav, mixed with the right elements of ras, the four first bhavas, awaken the devotee's original mellow or ras with the Lord. Because I actually wasn't clear, rati and ras. Even what's rati and what's ras? So rati is the attraction, the affection that you have there. Ras is what is the experience of it, the engagement, the thing that's going. Like I think of in this case, conjugal examples are good. If you tell someone, I love you, that's a very, it's a very powerful thing. That's your affection. But then that's all you do, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. That love has to manifest in, okay, where's the house, where's the car, where's the job, where's the money, where's the holiday, you have to do things to bring out the ras of the love for the person. So Rati is the affection, the type of affection we have. Ras is then the actual experience of it. So your Arati mixed with the Vaibhav, Anubhav, Satvikabhav, brings out our Ras. Any quick questions there on that point before I go forward?
What's an example of the stimulation in Vibhava?
Like a mundane example, I think Prabhupada uses, if a mother sees a child's shoes, it's something you see that it reminds you this person and the feeling you have towards them. In the spiritual world, often it's anything that a devotee has in identification with Krishna, like Krishna's flute and the sun. It's a very most obvious example. A devotee hears that stimulation and then immediately they're brought to the thoughts of Krishna. So the Sattvika Bhav and Vyabhachari Bhavs, they're set. There's 8 of these, there's 33 of these. Actually, sorry, all three, this last three. 8 symptoms, 33 emotions. Well, there's more in indirect ones, but 33. And 12, they're set. But the first two, the stimulations can be can be anything. There's categorization, but anything can stimulate. And then that what you do, your anubhav, that what you do afterward, that's also depends on you. Depends on you. So the first two depends on you, and the next three are structured items. So yes, so the stimulation can be something which reminds you of the person.
Is there a relationship between Staiva and the five rasas?
Is there a relation?
Connection.
Yes, definitely connection. So the Staiva is the affection you have, which combined with the four other bhavs produces your ras. The Staiva is the foundational affection or emotion that you have, which manifests. That's why last week's text, yesterday's text, was he mentioned the five ratis. And today's text mentions the five rasas. So yesterday we heard about Shantirati, that's it. Today's Shantiras, Dasyaras. So the rati is the affection you have, ras is the experience. And that's why I actually come to that, because I've got a main class is just trying to get our head around ras, the word ras. So 100%. Say rati is the foundation if you want one way to get ahead. But it's tricky. So then a quick summary of the Western notion. So then that's the Southern notion. It breaks it down. It gives quite clear explanation of these are the ingredients you need, the five bhavas. Then it brings us to the Western notion. This is the five rasas. The Santa Dasya Sakya Vatsara Madhurya. And then in each one you have the Vaibhav, Anubhav, Satvikabhav, Vyabhachari style. So the whole Western notion of the Bhaktivinoda Sindhu goes through the five waves, and each wave you get the five ingredients. So in Chantaras, what's the Vaibhav? What's the stimulation? What's the consequential action you do? What's the physical response? What's the intense emotion? And what's the permanent rati? It breaks each ingredient is then explained for each ras, what's required in exact detail, very specific details given. So then the next wave, dasya ras, what's the stimulation for one in dasya ras? What's the action somebody in dasya ras does? What's the anubhav? What do they do? What's their physical responses, the involuntary, and what's their heightened emotion, and what's their permanent rati? Yes, I'm sorry. So that's one of my questions later on. Please remind me, I'll come to it. That's one of my questions there, Ross. I have that covered, yeah. So that's how, that's how it's structured. The five waves, because each of the five rasses, and they're all broken down into these five in components for each one. So then, and this just one of the this point on each of the rasses about the fact that they have an order. So neutrality, what's the principal focus or basis of each of the rasas? So for neutrality on a Shanta ras, it's constant attachment. And that's why at this point how that of the five rasas as devotees and in the scriptures, some we don't give too much emphasis on Shanti ras. But Shanti ras is when you're completely free from anything material. There's no interest in matter of any sort. You're just absorbed in the Lord. You're just not doing anything yet with it. That's all. But it's complete absorption in the Lord. And even though in sometimes it's said in other scriptures or drama scriptures, Shantaras is not accepted as a ras. But Rupa Goswami says, oh no, it definitely is. He definitely says it's one of the five rasas. And actually one example Prabhupada gave. Anybody know example Prabhupada gave for Shantaras?
Yogi?
Well, no, a more for people who hadn't a clue, he'd give an example, physical example for Shantaras.
Chair.
The seat. He'd like to give that example. The seat. I'm sitting on the seat. The seat's not coming forward saying, how can I serve you? But it's giving me service. It's doing something. Yeah, I have a relationship with this seat. I'm not sure it's got affection for me, but Prasaprabha, the seeds of Shantaras. So constant attachment. Then servitude. So each of these build, each rasa, and that's one of the reasons why Madhuri is the topmost. It has each primary element and plus a new element. So servitude, the dasya rasa, has constant attachment plus a mood of service. What can I do? What am I going to do for the Lord? A desire to exchange, a desire to offer, to do something. Friendship, the constant attachments there. With a mood of service, friends want to serve, but the absence of awe and reverence. Because in servitude, it's very much, like we know, we're always, when we do some service, especially with senior, we're very awe and reverence, respectful, and that's required. But fraternity is then friendship, when that reduces a bit. The awe and reverence goes down because you're seeing yourself on a more equal level. Parental. Constant attachments there, a mood of service is there, parents are serving the children, increased absence of awe and reverence, plus a mood of being the Lord's maintainer and protector. In parental mood, the Lord needs me. If I don't do this for the Lord, he'll go hungry. If I don't do this for the Lord, he'll be dirty. If I don't do this for the Lord, he'll get sick. That mood of maintenance and protector. And then the conjugal is constant attachment, extreme servitude, increased absence of awe and restraint, increased mood of being the Lord's maintainer, plus serving the Lord with one's body as his beloved. That complete giving of everything, including one's body, to the Lord for his pleasure. Any quick questions on that?
What does it mean, giving body?
Well, it means giving your body. Physically, the Lord, the
dancing
and everything, whatever the Lord, conjugal means physical intimacy. Physical intimacy. The five, I think I've wanted each ras, from dasa to conjugal, you can monitor the level of intimacy increases. So one thing increases intimacy, more intimate, more intimate, more intimate, more intimate, more intimate. So conjugal is the most intimate, very physical. So what is ras? So now, on this.
Question
there. Yeah, sorry. Because it's funny, the light, I'm not used to projector.
Do devotees in other rasas as well serve Lord with body, like dancing and like doing everything for the Lord?
Do they serve with the body? Yeah, of course. Some dasya rasa onwards obviously means you're physically doing something with the body, yeah.
But then is there any specific significance of this Madhurya rasa and serving Lord with body in conjugal loving relationship? Is there any specific significance of how is expressed through because it's emphasized here, we serve Lord with body?
Well, my first point would be is actually it's not discussed in any detail by Rupa Goswami in the Bhakti Rasita Sindhu, even though it's a very elaborate work, because he usually, the conclusion is we have to be hyper cautious about wondering about these things. That general simple description is there, one complete giving of even one's body in the Lord's service. And then basically, for the most part, we leave it at that. But it's just the most absolute giving, the highest sense of giving to the Lord. Basically, we leave it at that. That's best, we just keep it like that.
In neutrality, I'm not quite clear on it. Neutrality is present in Vrindavan, and it's often described, its neutrality would be the trees, the creepers.
The water.
Is that correct? Also, Prabhupada speaks about another neutrality, which the yogis may do.
Uh-huh.
But that's different than the neutrality
of the trees.
Trees, because the also like the cows, for instance, they also are mixed with Vatsalya Bhav.
Yeah.
Then they're neutral, they're neutrality,
yeah.
I think, but they have some, They want to give their milk for Krishna. Yeah. The tree is a neutrality, but want to give their shade for Krishna.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Okay, so I'll be definitely open to correction in a lot of this discussion because it is technical. But my understanding, there are two things you said are different. They're different. Now, when you say the cows might have Mishanta and also may have some Vatsalya, that's all pure. They're pure rasas. But comparing the yogis and Shanta and the trees Shanta is different. It's different. But actually, what the yogis have, I think, if I get this right, would be have a Shantarati. They have the inclination, but they're not doing anything. It's not ras. The trees are complete ras. The water's got ras. They're engaging. They're there for the Lord. The Lord comes and takes fruit of the tree. The relationship is going on. It's complete Shanta ras. The yogis and those who aren't there yet, they've got Shanti Rati. They've got that, if they've done it right, they've got that interest in the Lord, but they're not doing anything yet. It's Rati. The Bhavas haven't manifested. The ingredients are there to exchange with the Lord. And that's why it said the yogis, they have no idea of Krishna really. It might be Vishnu, or maybe if they're a little better, it's Lord Narayan. But they're different. So a mixture of a resident of Vrindavan, or any resident of Vrindavan having a mixture of rasas, they're all pure Shanta pure rasas. But those examples are examples of those who have the affection but not the ras yet. That's
very clear, thank you.
So let's go. So what is ras? So Prabhupada gives these basic four words. It's a mellow, it's a taste, it's a humor, it's a relationship. Because it's often you hear about ras. Ras is a hard word to translate into English. Mellow, taste, humor, relationship. They're the four words most commonly used to understand what is ras. When our attraction, our rati, is matured by the supporting bhavas, we can have ras. That's back to our southern ocean, these bhavas, which the last one was stai bhava, our rati. When those four things is matured, it becomes your ras. Think of that one way. I like the word mature, that helps. Rati is what you have, but you're not really, it's not developed, not mature, it's not so available yet. So on our attraction, our rati is matured by the right bhavas, we have ras. Ras, in other words, intimate emotional exchange between the Lord and his devotees. And that's why the tree may be Shantaras, but there's an emotional exchange. The tree has is having this emotional offering to the Lord. The juice of the fruit of devotional service. Ras is often where the word juice. Not just the fruit. A fruit's one thing, but when you blend the fruit and you just get the juice, it's much more tangible. So it's very direct, tangible. And then this is also given the taste of getting drinking something very nice when we are thirsty. And we all know when we're parched and we're like, I need something to drink. That satisfaction when you get some liquid when you're really thirsty after pumping it out for Harinam for 2 hours and there's nobody's had the intelligence to bring water. Often you get that water. And then if it's something sweet, oh Lord, it's just the best. It's just that nectar taste. So that's a mundane way to understand the taste we get in drinking. Something very nice when we are thirsty. And thirsty means I need it, I want it. It's a very essential part of us, that hankering for it. So there were kind of some technical breakdowns what RAS is. So now I've got just my own general points in RAS, and here I'm going to be a little more, I'm open for adjustment or correction or discussion. It's the motivation and impetus for everything we do. Everything is based on RAS, everything. Sometimes we say happiness. Why is there anything? Why do people do anything? Because the happiness it gives you. But actually, it's the more technical word, it's the RAS. Everything has RAS. Ras is as all pervasive as our service. We all get the example of service, right? What's the Krishna? We are all eternal servants. Ekala Ishvara Krishna. Give me a bit of supporting Sanskrit here for we are all for nothing but service.
Krishna makes everyone dance as he goes the world. Krishna
serves. Okay, Krishna. Even more basic one, I'm sure you're getting there. Jivirasubhaya Krishnichidas. And we explain to people that you might not be serving Krishna like we're doing, but you're serving somebody. There's no difference in what you and I'm doing. We're both servants, 100%. You never leave your conscious position of being a servant, ever, ever, ever. It's just who you're serving, that's all. So you never leave your ras either. Your ras is what you consist, what you're made of. You're made of your ras. It's just a matter of being on the next point. Everyone has it. It's just a case of what we have it for, which Prabhupada then often uses the word actually perverted, misdirected, especially the word perverted. He likes this word, and it's a good word, because if you call someone, hey, you pervert, it's not nice. It's usually who are you calling a pervert? So it's a nasty word. It's an unpleasant word, and that's where everybody is. Everyone's a pervert in the material world. Sorry, not so and so is a pervert. He's a pervert. He's done this, that. No, sorry, you're all perverts. It's a world of perverts. Because you're all doing the wrong thing. You're all looking for that and going in a really weird place for it. I mean, just going such a wrong place for it. So that's why actually people get excited about things like criminals and perverts. The material world, everyone's a criminal and everyone's a pervert. Everyone, that's why everyone's in the prison house. Because we're all guilty of these things. So it's real. The taste is real. That desire is real. And that's why we say with the biggest one of sex desire, it's real. Don't try to deny it. Don't try to pretend it's not there. Especially when you're struggling with it. That's the worst time to pretend it's not there. It's very, because it's your ras. It's what you feel for Krishna. It's just misdirected. It's just gone, it's perverted direction. So we have to just redirect it, bring things back. Deny nothing. That's why Krishna consciousness, this karma, gyan, and bhakti triad, and the karma engages in glorification, the gyan engages in demonization, and the bhakti engages only in utilization. We don't excessively glorify anything, we don't demonize anything, we just utilize everything, especially our feelings, especially our emotions. It's eternal, it's already fixed up what our eternal ras is. We have an eternal ras, and it's set. And then I think, so then back to Nam Sanktanapu's question. Our original ras really starts to manifest when the devotee is on the stage of bhav. This is where we can, when we've gone past the Shraddha, Sarasanga, Bhajana Kriya, Nartani Vritti, Nishta, Ruchi, Ashakti, Bhav, Prema. When the symptoms, and that's what the book's about the symptoms, when this is happening, then you can even start to think, maybe my ras is manifesting. Until bhav, and that's like up there, it's a completely redundant discussion for sadhakas. Not completely redundant, no, it's got a role to play. But the idea, that dangerous water of entering, of what is my ras, it's dangerous, it's wrong, don't go there. Until you're on stage above. But discussions of it's required, and Prabhupada's books, it's there, and we have it. But we have to do it in the right way. And from our perspective, all rasas are absolute, completely spiritual. But from the transcendental point of view, each ras possesses more quality than the previous. I have a question later on, actually. What's the one common question devotees often ask about sometimes about rasas? Can we change? Can we change ras? Is that question okay? Because I've heard it quite a few times. My question, is that question okay? Is there anything wrong with that question? When we get the spiritual world, can we go from one ras to the other ras? Is there anything wrong with the question? Anybody see any issues there?
Lesser, you're thinking.
Yeah.
Materialistic conception.
Yeah. Very much so. So, and this is where we have to be very cautious. We hear this hierarchy, but we have to be very careful that we do, because that question basically, if you've ever asked it, whoops. Because what you're doing is you're taking, because the implication of that question is that, well, what if I'm in Dasyurās? Vatsalya's better. I want to be. It's taken our mundane idea of something's better and something's lacking. If I'm here, I'm lacking. That's a completely mundane concept. In the spiritual world, there is nothing lacking in anything. There is a hierarchy, but nothing lacking. There's no sense of lacking in the Krishna's devotees. Nobody feels lacking. I'm missing this. That doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. But when we think of it and we put this mundane idea, if he's Vatsalya and I'm Dasya, that's not fair. Or they're better than me. The question implies that mentality. And there's an example of how we have to, when we ask a question, we have to see what's the underlying consciousness there. So they're all completely transcendental. We shouldn't think. I like this point. This is one point Prabhupada says. Oops, sorry, number 7 first. The basis of how we attract people. Prabhupada says, you have to create ras. And actually, maybe that's then back to also one of them, Sakyatambu's points of what is ras. What did you say earlier at the beginning?
Giving out the fruits.
Yeah, giving out the fruits. That's in the analogy, giving out the fruits. So it is an important stage. People are attracted based upon ras. That's what they're attracted to. Philosophy, okay, it's a little bit of a interesting area, but what pulls somebody in is, I have this ras, wow, and I was actually saying to Murli Mahaprabhu this morning, for me, for quite some years, Prasadam was great, I could not possibly eat enough till I was rolling out the door, but it wasn't till the ras of a Kripa Maipu Kirtan and Rata Yatra that, well, that was it. No more dancing to anything else. I'm only going to dance to this Hare Krishna, because I had a ras for dancing, but now this ras was just a whole different experience. So that's what draws us in. It's ras. We have some taste. So when we're exchanging with people, that's really what we're thinking. Do I have some ras for Krishna? Do I have some taste for serving him? When you attract somebody, that's what you're doing. You're sharing your ras. And it's very, very important how we... So we have... And everything we do, every element, back to the... our first bhava. What's our first bhava called? What's the first of the five types of bhava? What's the first bhava called? Yes, who said that? Yes, thank you, Ganesha. Vibhava, the stimulations. Everything around, when we do anything in Krishna's temple, we can meditate like that. We're creating the vibhava of the ras to attract somebody. We make something beautiful, we make it clean. When the prasadam, of course, is first class, these are all vibhava of ras to attract somebody to Krishna. When we do things very nicely, it's ras. And when we don't do it nicely, it's not nice. People aren't attracted, we know that. What's the next point? Okay, ras is how we understand God as a person, that Krishna is a person. If we are only to understand him in general philosophical terms, all great, all powerful, then for sure all we can do is turn to the material world to satisfy our need of ras. This is one reason why Bhakti Rasmi Sindhu is so important. We have to know that Krishna has these, everything we possibly want to do in exchange, it's there. And if you don't know it's there, if you think, well, he's great and powerful. Yeah, great and powerful is nice. I want a friend. I want a friend to sit down and talk with. And if God's not that person, then I'll go look elsewhere for it in the material world, and that's why we're here. But Krishna is rasa murti akila. Akila murti. He's the essence, he's the embodiment. Everything that's any ras that exists 100% they're all in Krishna. So every desire we have, Krishna has it. So we have to know this. Otherwise, why would we surrender our entire being? Unless we know that that person who we're surrendering to has everything I possibly need, including, most important, not possessions, but relationship, but love. Krishna has that. He can 100% exchange love. So it's really important. That's why we hear in other religions, he's all great, all powerful. Very nice. It's true. But is it enough? No. No, we're not going to attract people with that. People have to hear about how Krishna is all friendly, all surrendered, and all loving. and then it's, so it's very important to thank God Krishna's a person. And here's a funny point Prabhupada likes to make too. We only exchange ras with the same species. So before we even contemplate our ras with the Lord, we have to become fixed first in understanding of our nature as spirit soul. This is why Prabhupada calls, we know, one of our first points. You're not the body, you're spirit soul. And Prabhupada gives the example, even in mundane terms, because everybody's engaged in some ras, right? In mundane terms, but the ras has to be between them species. Two fish, if they want to have conjugal ras, has to be two fish. Or two dogs, or two cats, or two kangaroos, or two elephants, whatever it is. It's not between different species, they don't exchange. It has to be between the same species. So if we want ras or Krishna, we have to have the same species. We have to come to the same spiritual understanding of our nature. Then it can start to happen. In other words, we have to understand we're not the body. We are not the body. And to the degree we're not the body, that we're spirit, then basically that's a Prabhupada's simple summary explanation of what's going on in the whole Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Prabhupada does things in such a boiled down way. He boils things down to so simple. But yet everything is contained in Prabhupada's simple presentation. You have to understand your spirit soul, and then all your rasas with Krishna will follow. Just by understanding you're the same species as Krishna. So it's kind of a nice little funny point. So I'm getting close. Let's see, what else do I have? Okay, I kind of did these ones briefly. The five rasas from neutral to conjugal have a gradual increase of important element intimacy. Each one is more intimate. And actually, I've done this already. If a devotee asks the question, how can one change one ras, what's wrong? So I've done that too. Okay, so I've done that. Now, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu and Nectar Devotion protect us from becoming full-blown members of two groups of people. Srila Prabhupada talked about a lot. What's these groups of people? Okay, so that's number two. What's it, first in the first category?
Maivad.
Maivad.
And
Bhakti Sahajis. Okay. How does Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu and Nectar Devotion protect us from becoming our Maivad? How does it do that? It's personal. Yeah. Maivad. By understanding that every ras that I possibly want, that's what Prabhupada often says, Maivadis, they're in a sick, diseased condition. Therefore, they think there's no healthy condition. Every relationship I've had has hurt me in some way or other. Therefore, no relationship. No. We say no. They've hurt you, but they're real. You still want it. Don't cut your head off if you've got a headache. That doesn't help. Just cure it. Redirect it. So Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu gives us great detail about Krishna as a person. That's why we have this whole, in this, okay, here's another, okay. When we hear about the qualities of Krishna, what type of Bhava is that? Come on. Give it to me.
Yes, it's Vaibhav.
Thank you. It's a stimulation. That's why it's there. We need to hear about Krishna. It stimulates us. Wow, he's a person. That's why the whole book is full of all these constant, beautiful, sweet little references. Krishna does this, and Krishna does this, and he does this. And you get it. The more you read it, the more you go, wow. It just makes us go a little wow. And Prakriti Sahaja, how does it protect us from Prakriti Sahaja?
It's a regulated process.
Yeah. And specifically, regulated process, that's the first stage, and then the other oceans, the southern and western. How?
Martin Abruzzi describes the science of development.
Yeah.
Which includes sadhana bhakti first.
Mm-hmm.
And then development bhava.
Okay. So what do we avoid doing?
Imitating.
Or taking it cheap. That's the problem. That's why they take it cheap. So when you read Nectar Devotion, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, it removes any chance you're taking it cheap. Because here it is, point by point by point by point by point. And one of my favorite things that comes up repeatedly is how you can get some little taste, but don't think it's the whole thing. Don't mistake it. Because that's a very common fault a devotee can fall into. A premature idea that, whoa, I got something there. Maybe I'm up here. Maybe I'm through. Maybe I'm starting to get through Narti Vritti. Maybe I'm on the stage of Nishta. Then one of the key reasons devotees might stop the process is just disappointment. After X amount of years, you find out, oh my God, oh my God, what's going on now? What is this? I didn't expect this. This can't, oh, it can't be me. And then we get, and then we kind of, maybe, and then again, we maybe go off looking for the Ras somewhere else. That's what devotees do. That's what we see happen all around us. Because they're not clear, they're taking things cheap. So a clear understanding of the science of how it's meant to develop will stop us taking it cheap. And therefore we've got very clear expectations, what's required, and therefore when it happened, okay. Little shadow, little taste. It's very nice. So it stops us imitating. Of course, in ISKCON we're pretty sure, the rolling on the ground, all that stuff we hear in India. But we also, and Prabhupada didn't talk about these for no reason. That's why devotees at the beginning said, why is Prabhupada always on about this group in India, the Mayavadis? Why was he always on about this? We're in New York in 66, 67, there's no Mayavadis here. The penny eventually dropped. Oh, he's talking about us. We're also Mayavadis. We also have impersonal ideas of Krishna. Same with Prakasahaja. Prakasahaja Brews is not some people in India who roll on the ground or dress up as gopis. We all have an intense, overwhelming desire in our heart to take it cheap, to imitate, to make it look like it's the real thing, and it's not. And that's why I find discussion with devotees, oh, but I'm so humble. No, I'm more humble. No, I'm more humble. No. Sorry, but I think that's a practice of Hajj coming out, because we know humility is the topmost thing, and we're trying to look like, look! Don't you see it? I'm humble! So it's we have the desire to look Krishna conscious, but well, actually the real thing, it's not really there yet, it's not really grounded. So the Bhaktivinoda Sila and the Prabhupada's net devotion keeps us grounded. So Mayavada and Prakritihaja. Now I think I'm going to have to skip my last section, because basically Kartik Chandra Prabhu yesterday, in answer to Dimitri Prabhu's question about why do we use practical service, and Kartik Chandra Prabhu gave a very nice answer. We have to know what our goal is. So, I saw this quote too. It's so important to know what our goal. It's so important to know what our goal is. I was reading the quote. Maybe I should read the quote now. I'm at a different point. This is another reason why we should. My Guru Maharaj, Bhaktivedanta Sarvadi Goswami Maharaj, he used to advise us to read Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Everyone after initiation, at least he advised me. That's Prabhupada saying something personal. So this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is very important, a study book for the Vaishnavas. It is the science of devotional service, and people are in Western countries taking interest. In the temple university, it has become a textbook in the religious class. Prabhupada liked that point a lot. They are using it in the colleges. There are 60 students who are regularly studying the Bhakti Nectar Devotion published by us, and gradually it's been introduced in other colleges and schools. Prabhupada wanted this book in colleges and schools, what to speak of us knowing it well, studying it nicely. And not just because we have in our Bhakti Shastra, we do the first 19 chapters. But as I was inquiring from Murli Mahaprabhu, as far as I'm aware, the other three oceans aren't covered by any of our standard curriculum in ISKCON. And I'm a little surprised, because it should. It should be, because we need to know these things. But maybe there's some reason we haven't. I know Hanuman Prasad Swami, he does it in some of his teachings. But Prabhupada wanted the book studied in college and schools. So, this idea of goals propel you forward, goals transform us, goals help us to believe in ourselves, goals help you account for failure, okay, I have time to go into this, but the reason why it's so important, and the psychological understanding of knowing what your goal is, gives us a first, okay. But I think I, hello, oops, okay, Hare Krishna. Okay, so we technically have 5 minutes, yes, so Namaskaram proof. Anybody? See, there's a bit of a whirlwind, so let's.
Hare Krishna Sriman Prabhu, thank you very much for a wonderful multimedia class. The question is regarding the experiencing ras with the same species.
Uh-huh.
You know this example Srila Prabhupada gives when it's our natural propensity to serve, to experience this ras. And when people don't have anyone to serve for, they get pets, dogs and cats. And once this question we were discussing in our mentee group, and the next day, Jayadvaita Maharaj was here. So Jayantai Prabhu asked this question to Jayadvaita Maharaj. And Jayadvaita Maharaj said, are there any other questions? So he didn't answer.
Ah, really? Okay. So, I was coming across a reference, and we know Mathuresh Prabhu. Mathuresh Prabhu used to be a first-class writer for Bhakti Godhead. And he's very intelligent, very nice writer. And he kind of addressed the point by saying, some ras is there, something is there. Of course, that's why people have a dog. Especially dogs, actually. I think that's why, I know, I see myself every so often, I see a dog when it's like, and it goes up to the person, it's like, dogs somehow or other have this ability, like cows don't do that. Okay, sometimes we see cows running a little bit, but cows aren't so obviously emotional, but dogs are like, they're like, look sad at you and they look happy and, basically, I had a dog that was super intelligent. It was too cold. It'd wrap its tail under its backside, lift its leg up, and look at it like this. He knew how to turn it on, how to look sad, to get inside the house, and he was cold. So somehow they have this capacity. So people are, but it's a sad indication of the age. People are so emotionally starved that they turn towards dogs, because even more so than cats. That's why dogs have an ability as a species to somehow demonstrate some of the soul's emotional nature. So people are so, and again, Monihapu, we were discussing about lonely, people are so lonely nowadays. The whole present Western industrial system is so horrible, people are just getting more and more and more lonely. And actually this week there was this huge statistical, shocking statistical report coming out in the UK Health Service. Things have, in the last 5-6 years, people think everything, every problem has doubled. In 5 or 6 years. The last time they did the report was 2006 or 7, or maybe more than 5 years. But children hurting themselves, doubled. People going in for dementia, doubled. Something else. Horrific statistics. Horrific in a few years. So it's like, whew. So people are turning towards an animal to get some ras, but we know they don't really get it. You have to be another human. So it has to be of the same species. You get some reflective idea of the ras, but not the real thing. You don't really get. That's why we know people with dogs, something is there, some companionship. Some, it shows me some affection. It likes me. Somebody likes me. Something likes me at least, but it's only a dog. But we want to be people. So same between animals. Even though I actually realized I just tried to do something that Jaya Swami didn't do, so I'm not sure if I should. Bodhi going to a territory, I'm not sure if Maharaj didn't do. But that's my understanding. Some reflective ras is there, but not the real. They're not anything which brings any satisfaction, even a perverted satisfaction between mundane species.
But is it correct understanding that even between humans, the ras is not the...
Oh, 100%.
The ras, yes.
It's perverted. It's just more perverted between species.
Yeah.
It's just more perverted. Perversion, there's no depth. There's no bottom to how perverted we can get, as we hear nowadays. That's why everybody in the material world is a pervert. But then there's pervert and pervert and pervert. It's just, how sad can you go? We know it's pretty sad. So there's that. Okay. So,
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Shaman, for a wonderful class. I just want to, there's one question which you mentioned about the change of rasa.
Mm-hmm.
And, interesting here, I'm just reading in Sudha Bhakti Chintamani that sometimes a question is raised, I just more or less read that, is Raj Bhakti for everyone? So in other words, what about those who have relationships with Krishna's expansions?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the rasa. Doesn't Krishna consciousness revive that attitude in them for their relationship mm-hmm. with Dwarkadish, for mm-hmm. example? And the answer is no. The followers of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who understand and have faith in the permanence of Raj Bhakti may be servants of Narayan, form of the Lord, but by the grace of Lord Gauranga, he awards them devotion, residence, and form of Raj Vasis. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains this while speaking to an assembly of devotees, including Awaita Acharya. Then there's one quote where he's saying, I will give you, if your relationship is with me, of Lord Brahkadish, of your rasas, and then I will make you my eternally liberated associates in Goloka Vrindavan. So the conclusion drawn from this and other such statements by the Gaudiya Vaishnava Acharya is that Krishna conscious movement provides for its followers a place in Goloka Vrindavan. Whatever their constitutional position, devotees are promoted to the topmost abode to relish the topmost mellows of love. This is the essence of Lord Chaitanya's mission, to give love specifically for Krishna, Krishna Prema Padayati.
Okay. So all I can do there is quote the wonderful speaker on Thursday, who basically said, it's been said from the seat, so I can quote it. Lord Chaitanya then does what he wants. Lord Chaitanya does what he wants. And that's, at one point actually, that's why he doesn't come very often, because he just does what he wants, and he just follows nothing. So, again, both points, the original establishment structure can be there, and then there's Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, again, but I daren't comment any more than quoting that Acharya who says, Lord Chaitanya breaks all the rules.
Same time it's described, but if devotees still, if despite ISKCON's teachings and Lord Chaitanya's teachings, if they still don't make use of these teachings of Raj Bhakti, then they cannot be forced. Of course, if devotees have no knowledge or faith in Raj Bhakti, if their firm devotion is reposed in the Vaikuntha forms of the Lord, then their destination will accord with their desires. Lord Chaitanya implies this in the above quote, which states that he awards devotees Raj Bhakti on the condition that they have faith in Vrindavan. If despite ISKCON's directing its members to Krishna and Vrindavan, some devotees remain firmly attached to another destination, then surely Lord Chaitanya will fulfill their desire in that regard. However, this would be an exception rather than a rule.
Yeah, so that's why we have the famous Murari Gupta situation in case of that. So we could draw from that, therefore, that those who are attracted to ISKCON and those who stay with it and those who are attracted to Mahaprabhu and those who stay with him, because everybody gets benefit from chanting Hare Krishna. No matter, everybody gets purified. But those who stay, the implication there are those who have that ras and there's either an instinctive sense or actually an awakening of it. This is it. But so in that sense it would seem to confirm that no, it never changes. If you don't stay, you might get the benefit of Mahaprabhu's mercy in so many ways, but then when you get close, then you gravitate towards that which is your constitutional ras.
Yeah, but it's saying here that even if your constitutional ras is with Lord Dwarkadish, then by Lord Garanga Mahaprabhu, he will change it. It says that I will fill your hearts with bliss. To you who have faith in Vrindavan, I will give splendid forms like my own. That is what I will do for you. Those who have hearts are bound to me in the forms of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, even if your rasas are friendship or servitude for Lord Dwarkadish, or if your rasas are friendship or servitude to any of my other incarnations, I will make you into my eternally liberated associates in Goloka Vrindavan.
There you go. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki jai. That's all I'll say to that. Okay, it's 9:05. There's a quick question on the lady's side. I better stop. Okay, Richard.
Hare Krishna. You mentioned an interesting example about the rasa in kirtan, that sometimes you can experience rasa and then you hear a kirtan from Kripa Mahaprabhu and then you say, oh, this rasa is nice, I want to go there. So I'm just wondering if there is, basically we were speaking that all rasas are kind of satisfying completely. So where does it come from then that you can be attracted by, you know, something from Ratha Yatra?
Of course, rasa in that context is just the preliminary interest. It's not one of the five rasas in that case. It was just, point is, we have a taste for something, and if we're given contact with something which is naturally higher, it's a better manifestation of the same taste, then we go towards it. So if I was interested in singing and dancing, well, this is just far better singing and dancing. So it's just, I just redirected my interest. I wasn't thinking this is a better ras. I hadn't a clue. I had no concept of that. And we're all attracted to Krishna. We're just driven by, hey, this is nice. That's all. It's usually no more complicated than that. Any of us, our first coming, hey, this is nice. Later on, we understand what's going on. But it's just, we're just drawn by taste, by an experience. That's all we're drawn by. Everybody's drawn by that to everything that they do. So we're coming to Krishna. Somehow or other, we have the good fortune to have that foundational state of our heart to appreciate, hey, this is better. This is better. We don't know why. We have no idea why. Why is prasadam better? When you first get prasadam, you have no idea. Until the devotee tells you it's been touched by the lips of Krishna. Oh. Now, if you don't tell people that too early, they might go, what? We don't know why. The why comes later. Just get it. Just get a taste. And that's why even in our point of, I had that up there about preachings about ras. This idea, when devotees first, too much emphasis on cut, telling people negative things. This is wrong, that's wrong. It can push people away. It can might attract some people if they're very ready for it. But most point people want pulled in by taste. And that's why Harinam, Prasadam is there. Because these things are full of taste, they're full of ras. So people hear it, and those who are fortunate, those who have their hearts ready for it, they follow the kirtan. They follow that. We had two devotees in Dublin one time joined. Simply heard the Harinam, walked after and joined. Helen and Beryl literally just walked in the temple that day and joined after hearing one Harinam externally. Because there was taste. They had no idea why. So you don't think like that. You don't think. It's just you happen to be ready for it. Why are you ready? That's the individual's path. That's where each of us. How many people in Oxford Street hear Harinam? Most people don't follow us back to the temple because their heart's not ready for it. Because they're still convinced that there's a mellow or a ras in Debenhams that's better than the ras in 9-10 Soho Street in Govinda's. Okay, I better start. Jai Srila Bhaktas Sindhu Ki Jai Nectar Devotion Ki Jai Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Go Premanand Samadhe Bhakta Vrinda Ki.
Krishna. Thank you very much, Shyamananda Prabhu. We want more classes like this. So, I just read this course from yesterday from Sankirtan. Yesterday in Govinda's Devacharan Transcendental Restaurant, we served at least 292 customers and collected, claimed back 2,674.72 Lakshman points. Then in Radha's boutique,